according to the parish minutes, they were in 1894 had 11 members, which were appointed to the parish council. With the Reverend Suckland was the chairman of the parish council at that particular time. Most of the members were farmers and farm labourers from the village. The school that was built in 1884 was the school that I attended to when I in 1933. It was a church school, and it had three teachers. There was an infant teacher, a junior teacher, and a head teacher. The head teacher, when I first went to school at the age of five, was Miss Yaxley. Miss Dunmore was the second junior teacher, and Miss Hand was the infant teacher. When Miss Yaxley left to get married, Miss Widger took over as head teacher at the North Wootton School in those days. She was a firm believer in discipline. The thing she used most was the cane. If she wanted to get children into her way of teaching, many pupils received this cane, which was often lying on the front of her desk.
Well, I went to the old school till I was 9, and my father thought he should have a master. I was a bad boy, though. And the funny thing, I went to the school on the outskirts of King's Lynn, and you know, it's a funny thing, I knew they knew my father, because my father was born at the House on the Green, which was a beer house, and during a certain period of time, none of the pubs were allowed to open in the town, you know. They'd got to go 3 miles for their beer on Sunday mornings. So they knew my father. But, you know, as soon as I went to school and the boys went home and told their father, we got Henry Toller. Oh, I know Tom Toller. I know Tom Toller. That was my father, you see. Yeah, they took me straight away.
School, it was very good, really. Very homely. And the children all seemed to play together, and we had quite a good time.
How many people were there?
There was 72 pupils when I first went to school, and then it got up to about 78 by the time I'd left school. Most of the pupils came from the North Wootton Marshes, from the farms of Mr. Thompson, both the top farm and the bottom farm. These pupils, they had to walk to school in those days. There was no buses then until about 1932. That was when the first bus service was ran for the school. The children that came from the Marsh, they had to stop to dinner, and they were supplied with the sandwiches from their own houses. There were no meals at the schools in those days. The only thing was that the teachers would boil a kettle and provide cocoa or a drink of some warm drink or something for the children, which they were charged at a halfpenny a week for that. With regards to a play, the infants had a small playground around the back of the school, but the juniors and seniors, they played on the green in front of the school, between the school and the road at those days. Of course, the volume of traffic was nothing like it is today. These certificates here were given. They were certificates of good attendance at the village school. These certificates belong to my mother, really, Fredeline Mary Ward. She lived in Rose Cottage, Little Car Road. She was born on the 3rd of July 1898, and she died the 10th of December 1992. She was aged 94 years when she died. Also, we were given, she got medals, you see. Just put them up there like that. got medals too for the certificates. But of course, the last ones that were issued to her were in 1908. And I haven't seen any like this since. And I don't, I often wonder whether that would be a good thing today, to give the children certificates and medals and make them appreciate going to school.
It's not a school now, it's...
No, it's, that school now has been turned into a house. Next to the school was the reading room, which was kind of a village hall, where people from the village went to, well, there was a men's club, which was going every night, and whist drives. They held whist drives during the week and the weekends, and also there were social evenings, as I used to call them, when the piano and the dancing and some people put on small plays or things like that. These were things that sort of like the village life. We'll say it was village life when everybody congregated and sort of like made all the entertainment they possibly could, because in those days there was not even a wireless set in those days. Well, this is the Kings Lynn District Coit League Challenge Cup. It was presented by Holcomb Ingleby Esquire, the MP. And North Wootton were the first winners in 1911. Coits were played in both public houses, the House on the Green and the Red Cat, which is a Red Cat Hotel at the present time. The medal, which my grandfather, Walter Ward, he won with this cup in 1913. That was the third time that they won the cup. The water supply in the 1930s was from a spring in the sand pits. And it came through the woods, and then there were two branches. One branched off over the drain from the pits by a cast iron pipe into the into a small dike, and then through a bank with a glazed pipe high enough for a 2 gallon bucket. This was the water supply for the little car road end of the village. The other branch passed along the road, through the allotments, across the road to a well on the green, the village green, which was situated more or less on the corner of Priory Lane and Manor Road. There's a small green there, and the well was in the centre of this green. It was a round structure. It was about 15 inches, 15 foot wide by 10 foot deep, with steps leading down to a slab on which you used to stand to fill the bucket. The overflow from this well used to go across the road to a small dike that ran beside the wall of the manor cottage, and emptied into the blacksmith's pit. The water from the well was good, lovely water, really. I couldn't see actually anything wrong with it, but eventually they tested the water from the well, and for some unknown reason it didn't come up to the standard of the health in those days. So what actually happened was they went over to the King's Lynn supply.
Who was the old post office?
The first post office that I knew of was down in Station Road, which was Mrs. Page was the sub postmistress in those days, and her daughter Violet, she did the rounds delivering the letters each day. She did that for 50 years. Then the post office, after she gave the post office up, it was closed and we had to go to South Wootton for a period of time. Well, after the next thing that happened was that Mr. Golden came into the village to live in the house where the post office is now. And he used to work for Mrs. Bowen in Manor House. Well, she decided that she would build him a house, and she built him a house at the bottom of her garden, which was more or less opposite the blacksmith shop. And the post office was moved from where it is now to this new house. After Mrs. Golden died, the post office then was moved back once more into the house where it is now, and Mr. Ransom, Herbert Ransom, he was the sub-postmaster then, and he started up with a post office and a small shop as the shop in the village, which was in the house next door, which was Mrs. Raines started up with the shop. He bought that over, so he ran the post office and the shop together. Well, then after Herbert decided to sell out, he sold out to Graham Ward and his wife, and they took the shop over then, and post office. And after Violet Page retired, my wife took over. And she did the post round then for 17 and a half years, until she retired.
When was the lodge built?
I should say somewhere in the latter part of the 1800s, that part of 1800, I would say 1900, that was built by the Reverend Suckling, who was rector of this parish at the time.
And what was it built for?
Well, for his residence.
Oh, it was the vicarage, was it?
Yes, that was. He felt it as a vicarage for himself. Then, after he'd left Osborne, did Osborne come in next? I think the furniture people in High Street, King's Lynn, they came in. Furniture and all that sort of all the general furnishings and beds and everything for the household. And following Osborne, I think German, one of the Germans lived there. Then when Germans were there, I'd be about 10, and I'm now 79. And when Germans were there, and that was in the time I was 11 to 13 or 14 year old. I had servants in the house those days. There was three servants in this house at that time when I was a boy. I used to deliver milk here from my father's herd in the village. I used to bring milk here and supply chickens, my mum did. To these people, that was Bradford Lawrence then, Albert. Mm. Do you remember him?
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. And then I say, when Germans left, and I think after Germans, I think that's when Thompson must have come into the, bought this, this farm down here, round about 1924, I think, Mr. Thompson bought this farm down here at North Wootton.
There used to be obviously a railway line that
ran
from Lynn to Hunston and
stopped
at North Wootton.
Beautiful, beautiful, wonderful trip from King's Lynn to Hunstanton, all through those marshes I'm just telling you about, over the river, into Wolferton where the Queen, where the royalty used to land, and the cars were there to meet them to take them up to Sandringham, then on to Dursingham, Dursingham Marshes, Snettisham, Inglethorpe, Snettisham, yeah, Heacham, on Stanton. God, fantastic. When we were kids, so we run in on Stanton. We was out of those carriages and down that platform as hard as we can go, across the road and out on the sands, boots and socks all paddling. The children used to come right out of the Midlands here on Wednesdays and Thursdays. There'd be at least four long trainfuls of loads of children coming out of the Midlands, Birmingham there down to, whilst we were working on the land. They'd be calling and waving to us, well, because the trains went through my land. Yes, loads of excursions. We knew what to expect all through the summer. The three or four excursions coming down right out of the Midlands. We were the nearest to them in them days, you see.
Well, the station in those days, it was quite a busy place, really. I mean, all the produce from the farms was loaded and unloaded onto the station and off the station. Freight and passenger service was very good in those days. I mean, and we also had three men who were what they called plate layers, who did the maintenance of the line from Gaywood to Wolverton.
I mean, what was the atmosphere like on the day that the line was
closed? Oh, yes.
It must be awful.
The last train went through that Saturday evening. I can well remember that that night as I was down there and I saw that train pass through. It had a wreath on the front of the engine. And to me, it was a very sad day, really, because I think that would have been a great tourist attraction at the moment. I mean, I think we lost a great asset there in the village when that went through. And of course, there's no chance now of putting another railway through, I don't think, because, as I say, the station houses have been turned into private houses.
Yeah.
And
so we tried to save this one. Yes, three or four businessmen in Lynn, I knew some of them, they were quite happy to take this length over from Kingsland to Hunstanton, because during the summer season we had sort of a tram running, you know, just one big carriage running through there continually, backwards and forwards. We'll say from probably the end of April or May, the beginning of May, that would be going back right through, backwards and forwards, September, taking people down. You see, there weren't no quantity of motor cars about.
This is the door that the gentleman used to hold his ring out with the key and the pass for, make sure that only one train was on the line. You handed the key out, and then when the train got to the other end, the driver handed it out when the next driver came back, because in the end of the time it was only a single track. This is the site of the old Midland Railway. Us as scouts was able to purchase the back half of this site. There was no planning permission at all on the front half. The old sand line from the South Wooden sand pits used to be horse-drawn by little trailers right out to the marsh, onto barges, and then away to Belgium for glass and that. And then the stone came back via the barges and built North Wooden Church and several other buildings. But when we asked the railway which was our right of way, they say not up the middle, where this existing road always was, because behind Simon there was the loading ramps where they took all the coal and the livestock of the district and the sugar beet factory in Kingsland. I then mentioned that we got an underlaid dike, 14 foot wide and 7 foot deep. And so, do they propose shoring it? And they say, not on your nelly. Would you be interested in the front site? So we then bought the front site for another additional 1,700 and moved the planner permission from the back to the front.
And this was still a viable line from Kingsland to Hunstan. It was still viable. The lad was here and taking the passengers who got on and off the train for North Wootton, Wolfington, Dursingham, Snellisham, Heacham, all the way along. And this line was still viable, and those four businessmen would have took it on. I was chairman of the parish council at that time, and I was elected to help for North Wootton, you see, from the parish council's point of view. But of course now, they wouldn't let them, would they? They want them shut, Beechington. They want them all shut, so they overruled them, and they just closed them. And about 2 years previous, all the work they'd done, new gates and self-opening gates, you know, with a wheel from the signal boxes and the signal box, only 2 years previous, just to make them so they weren't viable, spent no end of money. Well, you know, this is what the ordinary people like ourselves and that put down to. Of course, they just closed them, didn't they? And that was the finish of it.
Is North Wootton still a good village to live in?
It is to me. Oh yeah, I wouldn't live anywhere else. I enjoy it here now. Don't get me wrong in that way. I go round the village and I speak to people. Mind you, I only speak to them that speak to me, because some people ignore you these days. But the one thing about the exhibition I found was that a lot of people came up to me and spoke to me who I'd seen before around the parish, and they just ignored me. But when I was in the exhibition and they saw what I got on show, they came and more or less spoke to me and asked me about different things, which to me was wonderful. I mean, I had three wonderful days as far as I was concerned. That suited me down the ground. They were the happy 3 days I had for a long while, really. As I've said, I like to show people things. If they come and ask me I'm willing to show them anything about North Wootton that I know, because there are still things that crop up. I mean, we've had all the old minute books out before this centenary, and I've read quite a few of them, and I've learned quite a lot. I've learned quite a lot. So there's things that I more or less knew happened, but the nitty-gritty, getting down to the nitty-gritty of it, I didn't really know. Because there's a lot happened in this village, really, as regards to the selling up of the village from the Castle Royston estate. When Mr. Wheatley lived here, that was when the biggest part, because his brother-in-law was the Castle Royston estate agent, and a lot of the estate was sold up. I mean, the houses then, I'm talking about the old Castle Royston estate houses, like the cast stone and brick houses that you see around the village now, they were sold for about £380. And of course, Mr. Wheatley bought, where the tenants couldn't afford them, Mr. Wheatley bought them, you see? Which was I suppose it saved the houses, but... Thank you.
It's near, I've got room for it. It's got one there.
Thank you. to leave the church. A collection will be taken. We haven't been asking for money while the church has been generally open. But from this service, a collection will be taken and will be put into our loo fund.
Did you say 100 for the camera?
Yeah.
Have you checked to see if they've got newspaper in their trousers?
Looks bad with flicker doing it, doesn't it?
Now okay. The next stop is the unveiling of the plat on the green. Or not to unveil it, which really is to remove the
Thank you, everybody. It is, in fact, an honour for me to be asked to be here today to help to round off your centenary celebrations. I was very happy to come. It's sort of a bonus of being president that I'm managing to get to villages that I otherwise wouldn't see. And I have to say, when I came here on Friday, I soon learned that this was a happy, friendly village and that there's a real community spirit here. So I've been very happy to be part of your celebration. And I thank you very much for asking. So it's my duty, I think, to unveil this for you in honour of your 100 years and to wish you a very full, happy and successful another 100 years.
This is remembering that it's Rogation Sunday, we've given thanks, and the tradition is, as you heard earlier, to ask for our Lord's blessing on all our work. Loving Father, you promise to supply all our needs out of your abundant store. Prosper the labours of those who enable us to enjoy the resources of nature, whether by farming, fishing, or industrial work. that we may render thanks and praise to you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Last off, it's a village hall for those who haven't seen it, and if you've seen it, to have another look and perhaps have another cup of tea to help swell the coffers of the old village hall committee. Thank you very much. And the sun is a shining.
One lady who's got to see her car now.
Oh, yeah.